Hi, everyone. Welcome to the Citizen School's virtual coffee hour. We're expecting a few more folks to be straggling in, and we'll just let them in as they arrive. But in the meantime, what we would love to do is have you guys take a quick poll, just to give us a sense of how you guys are doing and feeling right now. And then we'll dig into our agenda. All right, guys, thanks for taking the poll. I'm going to share with you how we did. All right, so there were 12 of you who answered the question. And the first question was, how are you feeling during this crisis? Looks like the number one answer with 7 responses is good. While things aren't perfect, most of our needs are being met. So I'm so glad to hear that. And I certainly hope that today's virtual coffee hour actually helps in terms of contributing to that feeling of your needs are being met and you're getting some good resources. The second question that we asked are, what are you most excited to learn about today? And it looks like our number one answer is mental health and wellness, followed by remote learning and grading, and summer activities for kids and employment resources round out that set. So thank you guys. I think this is sort of just a nice way for us to get to know what's on your minds right now and to jump in and get started with our virtual coffee hour. So thanks for joining. I'm going to share my screen so that you guys can see the presentation. Can you guys just give me a thumbs up if you can see the screen okay? Awesome, thank you. Today's coffee hour, we're gonna start with a centering exercise so that we will all be present for this time that we're gonna spend together. And then we have 3 panelists who are gonna share their perspectives with us. So this will include a parent coordinator, a campus director, and a life coach. And then we'll open it up to your questions that you might have. So if anything comes up, while we're going through this, feel free to drop your questions in the chat. We'll also give folks time to put voice to their questions if they prefer to ask it directly. And then we're going to spend 10 minutes toward the end of this just reviewing 4 categories of resources. This is remote learning requirements and grading, summer activities for kids while we're maintaining social distancing, mental health and wellness, and then some quick resources on employment and workforce support. And then at the end, we have a little bit of a surprise for everyone. There's a video that we want to share with you that we hope will leave you on a high note, and we will wrap up with a moment of joy. So with that, I'm going to dive right in, and I'm going to actually ask our life coach, Sara, to take us through a centering exercise.
Okay. Hi, everyone. My name is Sara, and I'm going to ask you to join me in a quick centering exercise. I'm going to ask you to just kind of get comfortable in your chair, settle in. If you want to shut your eyes, you can. Some people don't like to. Dealer's choice. You can do whatever you'd like. But I'm just going to ask you to breathe and be aware of your breathing, and I'm going to talk a little bit through it, but your only job is to breathe. So just settle into your chair, take a few just clearing breaths, kind of let everything out from the day. And then with your next few breaths, I'm going to ask you to think about breathing into your length. So think about breathing from your head all the way down to your toes and just really elongating. And in that, you're breathing into your length, which is your dignity and how you carry yourself in the world. So take a few deep breaths in, thinking about making yourself taller, longer. And then I'm gonna ask you to let your awareness drop down to your width. So if your shoulders are up by your ears from the day, let your shoulders drop down. Let your heart open up a little bit and really direct your next few breaths into your width. And in your width, that's where your heart center is, your sense of compassion, but it's also your belonging and your connectedness to your family, to your friends, to your community. So really take some deep breaths in and let that center open up. And then on your next few breaths, we're going to think about your depth. So from front to back, and I want you to imagine, if you would, that you have like this giant dinosaur tail behind you, like a big T-Rex tail. And you can kind of lean back into it at any given moment. And that tail is comprised of everything that's come before you, all your past experiences, your successes, your capabilities, your amazing competencies, everything that makes you who you are. And even though it's in the past, it's right there supporting you in this moment. So really think about the fact that everything you need in this present moment and to move you forward, you have with you. And it's supporting you. So maybe take a few more deep breaths. Just trying to let go of any stress you feel anywhere in your body. And then when you're ready, just open your eyes and come back and join us.
Sara, thank you so much for that. I know I already feel 10 times calmer than I did 5 minutes ago. So that was incredibly effective. I hope you guys feel the same. We wanted to make sure everyone felt the presence of really taking the time, feeling calm, and being here with each other over this hour. A few things before we launch into our panel. Just wanted to remind folks that if you are not talking, just go ahead and mute yourself. And if you don't do that and you forget, no worries. We have some folks here at Citizen Schools that are going to mute you unless you want to talk. The other thing is that we are going to be monitoring the chat. So if at any point in time you have a burning question, feel free to throw it into the chat and we will definitely get to it. And then lastly, because we're trying to keep this as a resource for folks who couldn't make this time slot, we will be recording this session. So if you have any reason why you don't want to be part of that recording, no worries, just drop me a note, let me know. And I will make sure that you are not part of the recording when we edit this out. And lastly, along those lines, if you did not register in advance for this virtual coffee hour, but you want to receive the presentation afterwards, just remember to fill out the exit ticket at the end and provide your email address, and we'll make sure you get a copy of the recording and also any resources that you request. So with that, I'm actually going to turn it over and ask our panelists to introduce themselves. So we're going to start first with Amanda and then work our way across the screen.
School of the Arts, and I see some of my colleagues. I see some of my colleagues on here. So thank you for joining us and supporting us at Citizen Schools. And I am a mom of four and a stepmom to two. And I am really, really excited to join you guys today. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Sara. I live in Asheville, North Carolina, up in the mountains. I'm also a mom. I've got two munchkins who are 18 and 21. And I was a teacher for 20 some years. And now I am currently a presence-based life coach. So it's good to be here with you guys.
Hello, I'm Terrance. I'm a campus director at Renaissance School of the Arts. I'm super excited to explore resources and dip into everything that's going on and supporting our parents and anyone who's joining us today.
Thank you all so much for being on our panel today and for sharing some tips and resources. I'm going to start off with a couple of questions before we open it up to the group. So the first question, that we have is, with the variety of teaching platforms that schools are using today, what are some tips and resources for figuring out how to adapt and learn how to use them? So it can be confusing at times because sometimes districts and schools will change from one platform to another. So are there any tips and tricks for how to learn a new platform? I'm going to start first with you, TJ.
Awesome. So this is one of my favorite ones as we transition into virtual and remote spaces. I learned to look for the three dots. The three dots mean additional information. And so no matter what platform you're on, you look for those three dots, you can start to teach yourself how to navigate the space. YouTube is my best friend. I use YouTube like Google. And so there's always videos to walk you through the process as well. But the three dots are my go-to. As if you were in New York, we filter through a few platforms, and it really helped me out to just look for those three dots.
Amanda, do you have some suggestions from a parent perspective as well?
Yes. So from a parent perspective, I use the tutorials that the platforms come with. There's a lot of the time when you get on, there's these little icons that pop up on the screen. And a lot of times I've noticed that we like to skip them because we just want to hurry up. I took a step back and I started to slow down during remote learning. And I started to use those little tutorials, and they come with pictures and they come with arrows. So they show you everything on the screen that's important to use at the moment. Another thing I like to do is to share my screen. So I'll FaceTime someone that knows how to do it. For instance, TJ and I do that a lot, where we show each other our screens on FaceTime, and he'll just teach me like what to do where with what button and vice versa.
Thank you both. What are some time management tools and habits and routines that you've developed over time that seem to work well? And what sort of advice can you give other parents about developing those time management routines? Amanda, I'm going to start with you first.
So for time management, whew, God knows I need help, right? Whiteboards are my favorite thing. Whiteboards are magical. If you cannot get your hands on a whiteboard, because a lot of things were sold out during the pandemic, I would suggest to use Post-its and having a to-do list.
Amanda, any suggestions on where to keep the whiteboard or how to figure out how to use it with a family who may have several different schedules?
Definitely in your kitchen, because children eat you out of house and home. Put the whiteboard in your kitchen, put your Post-its on your fridge, and as the stuff gets done, you can take them off, and it's really easy to replace if you don't have Post-its and you have some printing paper or loose leaf that's extra around the house, and you can like make stick size cards, put them up with some scotch tape or painter's tape so it doesn't mess up your fridge. That would work too.
TJ, can you speak from the perspective of an educator and just knowing how different students are maybe needing some help about routines around this time?
Yeah. So for me, being an educator and a man of color, I am thinking about the pandemic that is COVID, and the pandemic that we're now also dealing with is us facing the systemic racism and all the protests that are happening right now. And so I think the number one thing I would say is to have a family meeting, a family discussion around how are we going to approach the impacts of what's going on. Do we live in a neighborhood where it's going to be a little bit louder for protests and things like that? Are we a family that are going to participate, and what does that look like for us, as well as what does the COVID pandemic, are there people in our building or family members who are impacted that? And so with that time management, I have a very controversial tool. It is a technology box. The technology box is where you collect video controllers or cell phone devices between particular hours of the day. This supports us during both pandemics because social media is flooded with everything that is going on, and it can be emotionally overwhelming, which impacts the enrichment work and the academic work that students are faced. Now you're independent learners and you may be used to group work, but now you have social media. So using that technology box to say, okay, every day at 9 p.m. or 10 p.m., we're gonna take a break from our technology, cell phones, and then I would say do a second wave of the video game, and explain to your child, if you haven't already seen the impacts of how sleep patterns have changed for a lot of families across the country. And so our families are saying it's harder to catch the teachers early in the morning and join those virtual sessions because they couldn't sleep all night, but they could play the video game and they could be on the phone. And so sometimes it's a difficult conversation because they're like, we're at home, but we're still in school. We're still figuring ourselves out and getting sleep and a break from what's going on around us will positively impact what we retain for us independent learning.
TJ, thanks for all of that. I think you've touched on a few different points there, and the taking a break, sort of having that time to pause, actually is related to our next question as well, which is, during this time of social distancing, which can be very difficult for families and for students, what advice can you give about coping and staying connected? So how can you continue to be safe and social distance, but still feel connected in some sort of way? I'm gonna start first with Sara, just to speak from like a mental health and wellness perspective.
So when I started thinking about this, I started thinking about the when the stewardess and the stewards on the plane are talking about how your oxygen mask will drop down. And as a parent, you put yours on first before you can help your child. And that's sort of the first piece of advice I have is for parents, your kids are gonna be looking to you right now to see what's going on. Like, how are we showing up as a family? Like, what do we think about this? And TJ touched on, you know, we have COVID and then we have this like, glaring pandemic where equity is not happening for us. And so that is a whole nother piece that's just sort of falling in the parents' lap. Now it's everything you're going to be talking about at home. So I would ask parents to really think about taking care of yourself first. I know that almost sounds selfish, but really just taking that moment to pause, and whether you have to leave the room to go take a few breaths to come back in, because again, your kids are watching you and they are gonna see how you react and how you show up. And it's important to model for them, this is how we wanna show up. So if you can take just a few minutes every day for whatever kind of self-care, if it's, like I said, you may need to lock yourself in the bathroom and just breathe for a little bit, or if you can get out and take a walk or just have a little time in the morning before the kids get up, you know, whatever you need to do for yourself is really important. And then I'd also put out there that we all have this inner critic that tells us, we're doing a terrible job at everything we're doing. And, you know, we're not working with the kids enough on their schooling. We're not getting done the job we need to do. I would tell that inner critic to please sit down and be quiet right now, because these are times like no other. So sometimes, right, TJ, sometimes just the fact that everybody got a meal and maybe somebody took a bath, like that is a banner day sometimes. So really let go of unrealistic expectations. I mean, this is, again, uncharted waters for all of us. So just, you know, maintaining, you write your to-do list, maybe you do one of five things. That is a day well done. You got to be with your family. And then my last advice is just really looking for positive connections right now. Think about who your people are that bring you up. TJ, you talked about, you know, putting technology away. You know, if you can't put technology away, at least limit what you're exposing yourself to. You know, if you're part of a faith-based organization, reach out to those people, reach out to family, reach out to friends, reach out to the people that bring you up right now and support you and maybe just make you laugh. You know, I've had a really crappy day and just talking to my sister, who I know always makes me laugh, it brings me back up so I can be ready for the next day.
TJ, can you add to what Sara was just talking about and maybe speak a little bit to the staying connected part as well? How do we stay connected when we're socially distancing?
I think a great thing that my wife and I discovered is that technology can help us bridge the gap with family members that we can't see. Our parents are older. So as much as we would have loved to help out in quarantine near them, one thing, we're coming from New York, so no one wants us near them. But also, my father-in-law is used to having a drink on Fridays with his neighbors, and he cannot do that. And so now we can do that virtually, and I think it can strengthen some bonds that may have been, maybe we left it up to the neighbor, or we left it up to someone who had proximity. But now proximity is no longer an issue, and so we get an opportunity to say, okay, how am I gonna take this, the FaceTime or the Zoom to the next level? So do I mail or order coloring books so that we all have the same coloring books and we can compare, because there are cousins and there are friends. And so we can do the same activity virtually. And I think an important part of that also is that you can also share songs. So visually we have a lot of technology, but like we can commit to starting our day to Glory by John Legend and Common, or different songs, and theme our weeks based on the different songs, so that as a family, maybe the children get to pick what songs get in the rotation. That can get very interesting. And so you can pick themes of music, but music is known to also relate to memory. So some of those songs that you might have a positive memories about, you hear them as a family. And again, it takes you on a journey through coping and reminding yourself that that was just a few months ago, that we were all in the same classroom together, that we were all laughing together, and then we can still have those laughs and have and create new memories in our new reality.
I love all of those suggestions, TJ. Thank you, and Sara as well. This is our last question before we visit the questions in the chat. So very much related to what you guys were just talking about. How do you create breaks, but such that you're able to continue student engagement? So I think this is one of the things that we struggle a lot with, is that it feels like sometimes these things are polar opposites from each other, having a break versus being able to keep students engaged. And we know how difficult that can be during this time. So I'm going to ask you, Sara, if you could speak to this first so that we can hear some ideas on how to take breaks when everything is online these days.
I think that's such an important question because I know that for me, days where there's like 5 Zoom calls in a row, I am done. Like I am checked out. And, you know, we know that through the brain and neuroscience, 20 to 30 minutes tops for us to retain new information. After that, we just can't. We're not effective. Just being able to look at your children and look at how they learn best, and maybe Amanda talked about setting up schedules for the day. Maybe you have early risers who have to get up and get all their work done early so they can be free for the rest of the day. Maybe you have kids that have to take bite-sized pieces of their learning. You know, they can work for 15 solid minutes and then they have to get up and do jumping jacks. And then they can sit back down again. So I think knowing your kids is really important right now to see how you can schedule that time. So when there is a break that needs to happen, it can be physical, it can be mental. I mean, you know, sometimes we joke in our house, we look at our dogs for guidance because they just shake everything off, you know, like they're standing in the corner shaking. And it's like, sometimes we need that. We need that physical, just stand up and walk away from the computer. And I would say just, you know, again, look at things you can do in your family that still relate to learning that aren't necessarily computer-based. There'll be enough computer-based, enough work, you know, workbook-based stuff that maybe then you do gardening or you do cooking together, and, you know, that's math, but it's measuring or, you know, whatever, a family project that you can do together, I think is you're still engaging, but it's a little bit away from the computer.
Thanks, Sara. TJ, can you speak to some of the activities that maybe you guys have done with students that take some of the online pressure off and maybe take some of those stuff offline?
Yes, we have a great campus director at our school, Mr. Jermaine, who has actually organized weekly cooking classes, and they're live. They release the ingredients to what they're cooking earlier in the week. And then on Thursdays, you cook together as a family. And so that's great. It's affordable. Again, you're tying in some of the measurement pieces and bringing math to life. There's also a great resource, Makers and Mentors. We'll share the link later. But there are at-home projects that you can do that are most of the items you already have in your home. And then parents can set aside time to participate in the learning process with the students. A great way to do that is implementing work hours and office hours and break hours. And so as you establish maybe the workspace, have your child and you create notes for when you're in office hours or study hours, and you put up a note because a lot of parents are balancing working as well as supporting with their child. So you can designate those times to say, oh, in the early evening, this is when we do our cooking class or our makers and mentors lesson. And when you see that I have my note up on my computer, that means you see so many news broadcasters, children walk into their live broadcast. And I think a tool that can help, you know, everyone out with sharing the house is creating office hours as if you're a little storefront and you're putting up your hours and when you're active. And it also allows students to exercise choice. And we work with middle schoolers, and choice is very important. And so they have the freedom to put the note up when they need a break and put the note up when they're on in a session with their teachers or tutors or a classmate.
I love that. Thank you so much for those tips. We're gonna now shift over to taking a look at what folks have dropped in the chat and just seeing if we can if we can answer some of the questions that have come up. So I'm just going to go quickly through some of the questions that may have been dropped in. And I'd also invite you guys to just put voice to any questions that you might have as well as they came up. I see in the chat some folks have really enjoyed some of the resources and some of the tips that have been mentioned. Would anyone like to ask our panelists any specific questions?
Yeah, sure. This is Nadia. Really quick. So TJ, Terrance, you mentioned earlier the opportunity for family meetings and things like that. And my daughter and I meet regularly, probably like once a week, we have like a formal dinner-esque type meeting. However, recently she kind of shared that she's like frustrated or is like no longer having fun at home and like within this environment, and often feels like she dislikes learning. Like, and it's becoming a chore where school used to be her thing, like she loves it, all of that. So I felt really bad. Because I'm like trying to balance her school and like home life and all of that. And I was wondering for just advice from the panelists in terms of like in your own experience or beyond from what you all have seen, would I be doing any harm if I actually just give her a break, similar to how like a vacation, like if I were to pull her out of school for a time period, like, would I be doing more harm than good?
TJ, do you want to start with answering that question? So I think what Nadia is getting to is not just like little breaks throughout the day, but it's sort of like extended breaks. How are we feeling about that in terms of the impact that might have?
I think one thing that is important to acknowledge with young people is that things changed. That we were very social, it was group learning, a lot of us, you know, it was really enjoyable just to hear other people learn, and then, you know, it was a more of a social impact, and that did change, and so acknowledging that, and I think with mental health and education, really communicating with schools around doing what's best for your child is okay. A lot of schools are releasing extended learning tools for the summer because students are gonna need to be a little bit fresher at the beginning of the year. And so this summer will not look like, you know, summers have in the past. And so I think, acknowledging it can really have our children explore what does independent learning means for them, and then how can they survey their friends and make it a social activity. So I wonder who else is feeling like you, and let's ask some of your friends and let's see what we can start. Maybe there's play dates that we set up that are similar to the academic sessions. And so navigating it with young people so that they feel heard.
Amanda, can I ask you to take this question as well? So in terms of just from a parent perspective, I know you spend a lot of time talking to other parents who probably struggle with a similar question.
Thank you for calling on me because I actually raised my hand. yeah, Nadia, I definitely encourage you to just unplug, especially you have a smaller child, and they need different stimulations. They need different things to do. So I have a 17-year-old and she was
Did we lose her?
I think she froze, unfortunately. We're going to roll with it because that's what happens when you have Zoom meetings. Hey, Amanda, can you hear us now? Can you try that again? We did not.
Oh, I apologize. You couldn't hear anything I said, huh?
No, but we can hear you now.
Okay. I was saying that I totally advise you to unplug for a little while. You have a smaller one. And I would say get some hands-on stuff, like kinetic sand with flour and coconut oil. And that's totally edible if she decides like she wants to taste it or something is like, I have a 9-month-old, guys. I look for completely edible things to do with my kids. Some sensory games with a Jell-O and different toys inside the Jell-O, just because they need things that are different than playing online. And smaller kids should have online on hands-on touch, like touch toys, just so that they're familiar with different things because they don't always understand what's happening online and they can't always comprehend what's going on in the world around us, right? So sometimes we want to shelter them, but we want them to know everything. And this is just a cool way that I have a bunch of nieces and nephews that we make ball pits in the living room and sand and art and paint. And it gets messy, Nadia. It gets very messy. But but it just takes their brain off of it for a little while. And then the next morning, they're up and ready to go and want to get on the computer and see their friends and see their teacher. And it's just like a little restart.
Thank you.
Thanks, Amanda and TJ, for answering that question. I'm going to move on to another one that was thrown in the chat. And the question is, what are some of the strategies that you guys have implemented during this time that you'll continue to practice when we return to standard social practices? So that's a good question. There are probably some things that are just as relevant when we all return back to quote unquote normal. So I'm going to ask Amanda if you wanna answer this question. Your hand is still raised. I'm not sure if that was intentional or not, but lucky you get to answer the question first.
Okay, yeah, great question, Gaddy. I am definitely advising using reminders and keep using the calendar. I know a lot of us use calendars on several different platforms and a lot of our platforms sync. So you can just use it in one place and you see all the meetings you have at one time. I know that on my iPhone, I'm able to do that and I can see what's happening at the office, right? And at home, all at the same time with my many munchkins. But that's a practice that I would love. I'm going to set my alarms, keep my whiteboard going, like I said earlier, and just having a lot of those reminders.
Thank you, Amanda. I'm going to ask Sara to please weigh in here on some, maybe some mental health and wellness practices that will still be good for folks after.
I think that is such an excellent question. I'm so glad somebody asked that because I think everyone is realizing right now, like this was kind of the weird cosmic pause, right? Like the universe literally just paused us and stopped us in our tracks and made us really start to look at, you know, just being at home within your family, within four walls. And that gives you a lot of time to kind of reflect. And sometimes that's uncomfortable and it doesn't feel great. And I think, you know, things that you find that sort of really support good mental health right now are things I think that were mentioned earlier that seem simple, you know, get sleep, try to get some sleep, try to take breaks through the day, try to do some sort of, you know, physical activity, whether it's walking around your block or, you know, if you can't get out, like, honestly, we used to do obstacle courses in our house when the girls were little and it was a rainy day. I mean, there's always something you can do. And I think that continuing those types of practices, even once you can get back out into the world, are important because they're self-care and they're care for your children. And I loved the idea that Nadia shared about like having that check-in with your child, having that meeting and continuing that. I mean, there's still going to be so much that's happening in the world, and just taking that time to kind of sit down with your child and let your child really feel listened to, no matter what their age is. You know, I think about the things within my household. I had two college students come home, and they're pretty independent with their online learning. But there were things like, we all take a break and go work out together, or at night it's sitting around and having dinner together and talking. I mean, we haven't done that in forever. So that's a practice I want to hold on to is, you know, even if we can't physically be in the same space, like I might text them after dinner, how was your day? What's going on? FaceTime and find out. So yeah, I just think taking the things that you're putting in place now to take care of yourselves, if you can continue those when life goes back to normal, do that, or any new rituals that you've come up with your family that really supports and nourishes all of you, continue with those as well. Those are going to always be really important.
TJ, can you jump in and answer this question from an educator perspective in terms of what are some practices that you think will still be good to maintain with students after this pandemic is over?
Yes, I think play and exploration have transformed during this time. And I think it's also a reason why there's a new energy behind dismantling systematic racism, because now information takes on a whole new meaning. It's like really deeply understanding the why. And, you know, because we're in the house, we have time. We have time to go deeper and explore, you know, what we've learned and why we've learned it. And so I recently, you know, saw someone taking a look at the incident that happened in Central Park in the observation area. And then she broke it down and she said, well, does anybody know the history of Central Park? And that it was a predominantly black colony that was then claimed as eminent domain, and Black, Irish, and other immigrants that were living where Central Park is now was then created. And I think some of the learning about systems that are beneath the surface during this time will help us connect as a human race. And that's definitely going to be needed as we re-enter social institutions. How we relate to one another from a biological level, from COVID to a social level with systematic racism will be different. And exploring and navigating information really could be on a whole new level.
Thanks, TJ. I'm going to take one last question, which is Norman's question from the group before we move on to sharing some very specific resources. And his question was, what are conversations that you have, languages to foster a cohesive connection between students and parents to keep students engaged that are feeling disconnected and need that physical space to do well with virtual space? So I think Norman's looking for some examples of what are some of those conversations that might happen between students and parents. So anyone want to take this first?
I can hop in. One thing that really worked out well is having physical activity during this time. And again, that kinesthetic aspect of learning. And I think what also acknowledging that this is very new, that typically you were spending more time with your teachers and classmates than we were as a family. So some hiccups may have came during this time. And so when it comes to fostering those cohesive connections, communicating appropriate times for to navigate topics. So not waiting for something to happen or someone to be like, I'm going outside today, I can't stay in here. But to designate times to say, okay, our time is posted on the fridge and this is what it's going to look like, you know, who has something. You don't have to have anything to bring to the table, but this week, this is what I need. I cooked a few extra times, so I need us to rethink the dishwashing schedule for the house and what that looks like. And so really being intentional about the things that connect you while you're in the home, and then finding some physical things that you can do for as stretching together, yoga, different things that you can do inside of the house, or if you have space just outside of your house to do together as a family, break yourselves up into teams, kind of do a weekly competition. And I'm a fan of Survivor, so you can start your own poll of elimination systems and things like that. But excellent question. And I think it's something that we're now becoming aware of, how important it is to the virtual space.
Thanks, TJ. So I am going to shift us to running through a couple of very specific resources with this group, just because I want to make sure that we wrap around 6 o'clock today. So I'm going to share my screen, and then TJ, you're actually first up to share our remote learning and grading. If you just give folks an overview, and we'll move on to the next resource.
Awesome. So I've broken it up into four sections that Anna will share with you after this. Enrichment, there's a lot out there, but I chose two resources that you can sign up for. I also divided our Spanish speaking educational opportunities so that those individuals who are, their first language is Spanish, that they have a system that they can navigate easily. And then some really great educational tools under education. And then my favorite, race and self-actualization. There's some really great tools here, some good books. Some of these books have free options online. So if you download the Kindle app or some other tools, you can have easy access to that. The best one yet is Know Your Rights Camp, which is Colin Kaepernick. They filmed all of the camps that they did pre-COVID and are sharing what were the outcomes for all of these cities across America. So it can be a really great opportunity for young people and parents to connect to what was going on a deeper level before we all became hyper aware of maybe one way to tackle issues. And so some really good resources there that'll take you through the summer and even beyond.
Amanda, you're up here to talk about summer and some social distancing activities if folks are looking for ways to continue keeping our kids entertained and learning.
Yes. So I broke up some of the resources here. My favorite thing, honestly, is the escape room. A lot of the kids have tried it at Renaissance, and they say that it's really cool. They give you some clues, and you don't realize that an hour passes by so fast. And they're really busy, and they're really looking for these clues, and it takes a lot of brain power. So it's under fun and games, but the kids are really into something and looking for these clues and being a detective and things like that. Another cool one was this free Microsoft virtual workshop and training. I went through and I looked through what they offer before I put it up. And it was really cool because it teaches you guys, it teaches the kids how to code. And a lot of it looks like Minecraft. And I know kids are into Minecraft at this age. And they had some stuff for smaller children as well that were tech savvy. So I really encourage you guys to get on there. And if you're like me and you're not tech savvy and you just want something to occupy some time other than work and reading, you can take a chance and go on these that different places to virtually visit list. And they have a ton of stuff that you could do and see, like Space Mountain in Disneyland. And that was really cool.
Thank you, Amanda. Sara, will you give us an overview of these mental health and wellness resources?
I will. So I did break it down just like everybody else did, kind of in different sections. I think what's really cool, or what I found really cool, was looking at any of these sites. You know, if you just go to NAMI, N-A-M-I, there's all kinds of articles that will come up, like right on the front page. Or if you have questions, there's a whole section of resources. Any of these websites, a lot of them had very specific tips and resources for parents, which I found really useful. It's like, I didn't want to just read these big, like, rambling articles. Like, I wanted like five things that I could do in my home with my kids during this time. Or in the mindfulness and meditation, all these resources, you can go on and it's like free downloads of a meditation you can do with your kids, or just, you know, that maybe you just want to do without your kids, you know, just some quiet space. And then I did also try to get, there's two at the bottom that will come up for bilingual families, and it's much easier to navigate. We kind of talked about how sometimes you can go to the other websites and there are areas you can click on to hear in Spanish what's going on, but they're not always great. So those I would suggest, the two at the bottom. And then, you know, TJ had some awesome resources talking about equity and talking about race. And a lot of these, the teacher in me came out, where in our classrooms, a lot of times books we read were really the openers for a lot of conversations. So there's a lot of books on there that are made specifically for adults to read to educate themselves. But then there's also a lot that are for parents to read with children that really kind of get people thinking about what's going on, and that it's been going on for a really long time now. And that is something to talk about. And it's almost like right now you have a captive audience in your home to have these conversations with your families about. And that's really, really important. And I think that, you know, just again, I go back to what I do in coaching a lot of times is I just hold space for people to talk. Sometimes really people just need to talk and you just need to listen. And what you say is not important. It's that person feels heard. And I think that right now, as parents, we have this excellent opportunity to really be present with our kids and to be listening to what they have to say about what's going on. Maybe like Nadia suggested in those meetings, like you really let them voice what they're feeling, their challenges, and then, you know, just being a resource to them in that way. So I won't go through all of them, but they were all ones that, you know, as a parent, as an educator, as a coach, I found were really engaging.
Last up, we have some employment resources, and there was a request that just came through that said, so if you are on furlough, some people have never heard of this term before. What does that really mean? And how does that really impact me? So there's a definition that I put in here. So it is a mandatory leave of absence for an employee, and they are expected to return to work. So this is not your typical unemployment scenario. A lot of companies and organizations have decided to put staff on furlough, or some portion of their staff on furlough. And it is in part because of the CARES Act. that you will be not only eligible for unemployment, even though you're technically still employed, but also because there's an additional $600 on top of your unemployment through July 31st when you're on furlough. So I included a link here, which also explains the details of what that really means. And then also shared some unemployment resources that are countrywide. So there's unemployment through USA.gov, and it will walk you through any state-by-state resources that you might need. And then there's an app that was developed called uihelp.org, and that is crowdsourced unemployment help through Facebook. So they actually have Facebook groups for each state, and you can ask questions and get crowdsourced answers to your questions. On the right-hand side there, if you are looking for essential jobs and employment opportunities, there's the Reemployment Center, the State for Essential Jobs, which is a list of available jobs in what's been called the Essential Jobs List. And then there's some specific New York City resources as well. We also included some Spanish language resources. You'll see the theme. We've tried to include at least a few of them in each one of these categories for four of our core regions that Citizen Schools happens to serve. So that includes Massachusetts, California, New York, and North Carolina. If there's a resource that you are looking for that you have not seen in any of these four pages that Amanda, TJ, Sarah, or I shared with you, feel free to message us about that during the exit ticket, and we are so happy to help you do some additional research as well. We have just a couple of minutes left. I did promise you a moment of joy. So I'm going to switch over and I'm going to show you a quick video. This one, courtesy of our RSA team in New York, what they did was they actually put together a cheer video. So one of their clubs is a cheerleading group run by Miss Sonia. And what we want to do is share that with you now.
Miss Sonia did that really impacted me was she helped me boost my confidence. The day before the pep rally and like right before the pep rally, when we were getting ready in the gym and like we were doing our hair and stuff and like she was doing my hair and stuff like that. She told me, well, she told all of us that we could do it and that we had it. And then when we did it, we all did it. I'm surprised that we did it because like I was very shy. But anyway, yeah, just thank you for helping me boost my confidence and thank you for helping me do what I had to do. So yeah, thanks a lot, Miss Sonia.
I'ma show you how to get it. It go right foot up, left foot slide, left foot up, right foot slide. Basically, I'm saying either way, we about to slide. Hey, can't let this one slide. Hey, don't you wanna? I could dance like Michael J. Son, I could get you satisfaction. And you know we out here every day with it. I'ma show you how to get it. It go right foot up, left foot slide, left foot. I'ma show you how to get it. It go right foot up, left foot slide, left foot up, right foot slide. Basically I'm saying either way we bout to slide. If you can't let this one slide it, I'ma show you how to get it. It go right foot up, left foot slide, left foot up, right foot slide. Basically I'm saying either way.